How would you respond to the public opinion that studying translation is not as competitive as pursuing for a business degree?
Competitive?
Yeah.
Does that mean you'll get more money if you do a business degree than if you do translation and interpreting?
Yes, this is the general
perception. At a master's level, I think that's probably true. You'll probably pay more to get the business degree, but your starting salaries will be higher, and so that's not helping us. However, if you're going into business and you have communication skills and you have language skills, if you have all those skills that you learn in the translation and interpreting degree, you'll do much better. You can advance in business because you have those skills. So I think the question has, if you like, a false dichotomy. Go for the business if that's what you really want to do and you can pay for it, that's fine. If you really love languages and working with people, do the translation and interpreting. You may become a translator and interpreter, but even if you don't, those communication skills will help you in any international business opportunity. So in some respects, it's a false dichotomy. People will find the jobs they deserve, no matter which path they take to get there.
Thank you. And what do you think are the differences of studying translation and studying English literature and language per se?
Yeah, I grew up, I studied literature, not just English. I did comparative literature. I like literary studies. I enjoy a well-written text. What you get, though, when you study translation and interpreting is all the live communication skills that you need to work in today's world. You can work on translating good literary texts, and there's no better way of understanding and entering deep into the literary qualities of a text than translating it. So that's a great thing to do, and I enjoy doing that. But I think when you do translation and interpreting, you should get a whole lot of communication skills at all levels of language, in all genres, and that's going to help people more in their careers than the understanding of complex literary texts.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes, thank you so much. Next question is, in what areas do you think that translation students that you taught are good at and weak in? That is there any room for improvement for translation major students?
Are we talking about undergrad or master's level, BA or MA level? Look, it depends. Some students are very strong in some areas and not in others. And the task of the program, especially at master's level, should be to help that student find their pathway towards a rich and rewarding job. What comes up very clearly is that at the beginning, most students secretly want to be conference interpreters at the United Nations. There are very few of those people. They're not going to get there. A lot of people start off wanting to be interpreters and they're told, or they realize, that they don't have the extremely quick and bright and active communication skills that are needed in the two languages, and so they go into other fields. What we found, though, especially working at Monterey in California, where we introduced some years ago a master's in localization and project management, that is, all the technology skills, we found that lots of students come in wanting to be translators, then they move during that degree into the translation, localization of project management, into the technology, because that's what gets them enthusiastic and that's where they find good jobs as well. Mm-hmm. So actually what's happened in the Monterey program is that of the masters that are on offer, we have strong students in conference interpreting, because that's a real market, strong students in localization and project management, and now very few students just doing translation, just doing traditional translation. Okay, so strong or weak in what, it depends on the individual student, but we're seeing that the strengths of the institution in its relationship to the market are separating into those two top end markets, high tech market and conference interpreting.
And asked about curriculum design and learning outcomes. So the teaching contents or teaching focus of translation majors at BA and MA level, do you think that, for example, the proportion and the balance of the curriculum design, should it be focusing more on the marketability, the market needs, or discipline or translation studies, pure academic studies?
Okay.
Yeah.
I strongly believe that the BA level should not be worried about professions. I think at undergrad, it's where students get language skills. They have to get very good language skills there, critical thinking skills and data processing skills. But they can do that in almost any discipline. And they should be free to experiment with different disciplines, input from different areas, and to go where their curiosity takes them. It's the only time in your life when you really get intellectual freedom. And I really think it's a pity if people come in the first, second, third years of their university studies and say, I'm going to that profession straight. They'll get to the profession, but they should experiment with ideas and experiment with their skills before that. At master's level, though, it's different. At master's, usually in the Western world, they are getting to be very expensive. They are very closely related to professions. We are training people with work placements and with quite personalized relationships with future employers. In Monterey, we organize market fairs where employers come in and look for the bright graduates. There, it's very different. There, you have to be in tune with what's happening in the profession. You have to work with professionals, and you have to ensure that the students get an easy bridge into the profession.
And this is a common question by asked by our students. Do you think that AI will replace translators?
Artificial intelligence?
Yes.
No. The reason is that people are stupid. I'll explain this just quickly. It's quite complicated, but machine translation, you have free online machine translation, you have Baidu in China, is only as good as the data that goes into it. So if the database of bilingual text is good and clean, the quality is getting much better and will reach a level of absolute usability. In some fields, in some language pair, it's there now with neural machine translation. What happens, though, is that people get the machine translation, they think it's a good translation, they put it on a website, or they publish it, and then it's fed back into the database. So the quality of the databases hasn't improved over time, which means that for some language pairs and genres, quality has actually gone down a bit, or hasn't improved exponentially, as you would expect, with pure processing capacity. So thanks to the stupidity of people who don't understand what machine translation is, the quality hasn't improved that much. Now, neural machine translation, as we've had it for the past 2 years, in theory operates on a smaller database, so it's not big data, it's small, clean, field-specific data. In theory, that will produce much better quality, and it will force translators to become post-editors, or pre-editors, or rewriters for the genres where you need a complete rethinking of the output, or people working in public relations, which is all the areas that the machine translation won't help us with. So yes, it won't equal human translators, but it will certainly change the kinds of jobs we should be training people for.
And one of the questions that our students would like to know is, what do you think are the most important translators and translation competencies that the market and academic studies need nowadays?
Mm-hmm.
And another important question is, do we have a future in studying translation?
Okay. Right, you need strong language skills. You can't avoid that. You should get that at the BA level. You should get that by traveling wherever possible and get that experience. You can't avoid strong language skills. People say translation competence is not the same as bilingual competence, and it's true. But if you don't have the bilingual competence, you're not going to do very well at the translation level. On top of that, the actual skills you need come with experience. There's a capacity to choose very quickly the best translation solution in situations where there are no rules, in situations where you operate on intuition and suppositions about the capacity of the receivers and the purpose of the communication. And those are very, very subtle skills that are difficult to formulate. You can't sit down and learn them. You get them through having lots and lots of practice. So what I would look for in a translation program is lots and lots of practice, especially spoken practice in an oral situation, because that's where you see if something works or doesn't work. So I think, for example, that all translation students, whether they want to do technology or written translation or spoken translation, all of them should start from lots of spoken work, the capacity to communicate in a triadic situation. Then all of them should do a lot of summarizing, the capacity to get a complex text and extract the main points, reduce a text by a third, for example, and be able to summarize a text. This is what Daniel Guadec did in Rennes. He would make them go for a whole year just summarizing before they are allowed to translate. So those skills, which are really data processing skills, in situations, have to come through practice. With the technologies, I think we make a mistake if we insist on teaching individual technologies. When I do that, what I get my students to do, I train them in 1, 2, 3 quite easy translation memory suites with a machine translation integration. And then I say, right, you've got 2 hours, now you have to learn a new one. And the students have to be able to pick up a new tool, learn it with online tutorials, do a translation with it, and deliver the product within 2 hours. What have they learned? They've learned how to learn. I think that's the key thing, the third key thing. Because our technologies are changing so fast, and because each client and text genre is different, we have to train people who can learn how to learn very quickly. And that's the third level that I would insist on a great deal.
The last question is, students, maybe some misunderstanding by common people. They said that I know, probably everyone knows two languages in China, in Hong Kong, for example. We both know Chinese and English. In America, maybe English, Spain, etc. So since we are bilingual already, why do we need to study for a translation degree?
Okay, I think because of the kind of skills I just mentioned, those rapid situational skills require cognitive mapping operations between languages. Now, if somebody develops as a symmetrical bilingual, that is, they've grown up with Chinese and English in Hong Kong and Cantonese in Hong Kong, you grow up with three languages, and your brain has those three centers where they're operative, and you switch from one to the other according to the situation. You might be cooking in Cantonese and go and study economics in English and then write your exams in Chinese. Okay, and you do that quite happily. Because of the way you've developed that bilingual competence, you haven't developed mapping operations. And you've developed spoken competence in those languages, which are systems. Now, somebody who learns a language late as an adult has one language base, they've acquired writing, and then they learn a written language from that because we open books. Now, they probably speak quite badly in their second or third language, but they will map very quickly from the written form to a written form. So this is what I discovered in Monterey, California, where we had heritage speakers of Spanish, people who grew up speaking Spanish and English, Spanish in the home, English at school. They come to be translators. They're not the best translators because they haven't developed those mapping operations. that people who learned late in life have developed. Okay? It's not a rule, it's not a fatality. Everybody can become a good translator, and some people are bad translators on both sides of that fence. But it does seem to me that in the field of written translation especially, perhaps conference interpreting as well, late learners, asymmetric bilinguals, tend to do better, which suggests a cognitive reason why translation competence is not the same as bilingual competence.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, that's all. Thank you so much.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Insightful.
Okay.
Thank you.